So I'm going to be speaking about what's new in upper endoscopy. And what I'm going to be doing today is, my objectives are for you to understand the goals for transfusion in patients with upper GI bleeding, to know the timing and role of endoscopic therapy for patients with upper GI bleeding, and to be aware of recent advances in endoscopic techniques, and then I'm going to finish with how to reduce rebleeding after endoscopic therapy. So I'm going to start off with a case. This is a real case, a 64-year-old man who had ampullary cancer and underwent a Whipple surgery, developed chronic postprandial pain and took a lot of ibuprofen, and then presented with bright red hematemesis. He was lightheaded, dizzy, syncopized, had a low blood pressure, high heart rate, had melena. His hematocrit was 22, BUN 30, creatinine of 1, INR of 1. And this is what we saw on his upper endoscopy. This was a non-bleeding, large cratered ulcer with a 6 millimeter visible vessel at the gastrojejunal anastomosis. So a big, big vessel. And I want you to think, how would you manage this? And I'll come back to this at the end of the presentation. So when we start with patients who have upper GI bleeding, we have our initial assessment of their hemodynamic status happens immediately. This is not a diagnostic dilemma. We know they're GI bleeding, and we need to get in the two large bore IVs. I can't stress this enough. Get both of them in. There are many places where they get one in or they're not large bore, 18 gauge and larger, two in. This is essential to resuscitating your patient. Blood transfusions, we're going to talk about more. The targets now are typically 7 grams per deciliter, but they can be higher. If there's evidence of active ongoing bleeding, intravascular volume depletion, active coronary disease, it's okay to give shoot for a higher number. And then risk stratifications to higher and lower categories, and these can help with patient triage and timing of endoscopy. So this is the Villanueva paper that's gotten a lot of publicity in the New England Journal, showing a restrictive strategy with a 7 gram deciliter target versus the liberal or more traditional 9 or 10 grams per deciliter strategy, and showing a difference in mortality on patients who present favoring the restrictive strategy. This was all comers with upper GI bleeding, and if you look at overall, the numbers are really quite convincing, but realize most of the benefit here is in with child A or B cirrhotics. These clearly are beneficial. The ones from ulcer was not as statistically significant in this study, although we've extrapolated that we should also be having 7 gram per deciliter targets. This assumption or this finding has been challenged by other studies. This is a study from the UK where they did this interesting randomized design where they randomized the hospital to a restrictive strategy or to a standard strategy where you transfuse if it's 8 grams or 10 grams, and basically there are no differences in outcomes. I'll tell you, my strategy is to have a goal of 7 grams per deciliter in most cases, but there are times where I do not do this because I'm particularly worried about these people who are actively bleeding or their comorbidities, and I'm not that worried about it. So the issues I'm going to talk to you about endoscopy are the timing of endoscopy, when do we come in, what are our ways of doing endoscopic therapy, some traditional ones, and focus on the new techniques, and how can we reduce bleeding. So the timing is simple in that all the guidelines recommend within 24 hours. Now, it's different from Dr. Abdo in his presentation of variceal bleeding. The timing is 12 hours. I'm talking about non-variceal bleeding, or those you suspect are non-variceal bleeding. In actuality, we don't come in within 24 hours in many of these patients. If you look at national surveys, we're in 55 to 60% of the time. And this is a study that was recently published looking at the national inpatient sample of 1.8 million patients in the U.S. with an upper GI bleed, and they had a couple of interesting findings. They looked at those who had an endoscopy to those who never had an endoscopy, and they found those who had an endoscopy were 3 times more likely to die during that admission. And I don't know if this is bias of who those patients were who we didn't want to do an endoscopy, and maybe they were dying anyways of their other diseases. But if you look at early endoscopy within 24 hours versus late endoscopy, there was a 50% lower mortality if you did your endoscopy earlier, and the early endoscopies were associated associated with lower morbidity, shorter length of stay, and lower total hospital costs. So it seems like we should come in within 24 hours. Well, how about more emergent? If 24 hours is good, how about 12 hours? How about 2 hours in coming in? Well, there have been a number of studies looking at emergent endoscopy, which is within 6 or 8 hours, or less emergent, which is I'm calling urgent here, endoscopy. The studies are all flawed. They're all retrospective cohort studies. But basically, if you look at those who had emergency endoscopy, you do more endoscopic therapy. If you look at outcomes of these patients, there are no differences. No differences in rebleeding rates, length of stay, transfusion, surgery, and mortality. So it looks like, in general, within 24 hours looks right. But are there some patients who may benefit from these emergency endoscopies, perhaps? Those who are unstable initially, those who have hematemesis, particularly large volume ongoing hematemesis. I'm not talking about your Mallory Weiss tears that stop on their own. So those who you think have ongoing active bleeding, and then always after you stabilize them. That's the key point here. And if you don't do this, there may be worse outcomes if you come in emergently. You may not resuscitate the patient adequately, and that's my main lesson here. It's like the pancreatitis story. You must resuscitate those patients to have good outcomes. It may be that you're doing it at night without the usual supports, whoever your nurses or techs are, maybe between 11 p.m. and 7 a.m., and you're not as good as you think you are in those hours. And so you may be fatigued, and your outcomes may not be as good. And if you get into trouble, you may not have backup. Your radiologists and surgeons may be home in bed, and bad things may happen. So you have to think about these emergency endoscopies. A number of groups have been interested in the May issue of GIE. There's a study published from my group, as well as a study published from Denmark, and I'm showing the Denmark data, the Larsen data, where they looked at all patients in Denmark and looked at mortality and time to endoscopy. And you see on the left of this slide is the hemodynamically stable group, and on the right is the hemodynamically unstable, and the two curves you see are ASA status, and the higher curve are the ASA 3 to 5. So what's really interesting, there are U-shaped curves in both of these. So the sweet part is somewhere in these studies in the, you know, 12 to 24 hour period. If you come in too early, the mortality is higher in these studies. And maybe this is partly patient selection of who we're scoping early, but maybe we're under-resuscitating them. How about prophylactic endotracheal intubation? Well, this may have a role. We think it's good in those who have massive hematemesis, altered mental status. Maybe we're going to protect their airway. Well, John Vargo's group just published on this and said, actually, there's a higher rate of aspiration pneumonia if you intubate your patient, and there's a higher rate of adverse cardiac events, such as shock. So think twice. Obviously, there's still some patients who will benefit, but you may also have risks of doing this. Now, we all go to the stigmata of recent hemorrhage and look at active bleeding, which has a high risk of further bleeding, non-bleeding visible vessels, which have about a 40 to 50% of further bleeding, adherent clots about 20%, and depends what under that clot, pigmented spots less, and clean ulcer bases. The stigmata may be a little bit more complicated, and people are looking more critically at it and saying, are they all the same? The active bleeding group and stigmata includes both spurting bleeding and oozing bleeding, and these are really not the same. And this is just one study showing from Dean Jensen's group differences in rebleeding rates. And if you look on the left side, you'll see the spurting group here, which is 22.5% of the time they're rebleeding. And then you got clots and non-bleeding vessels. And then the lowest group here was the oozing. So these are not as high risk, in my opinion, as the spurting bleeds. So who do we do therapy on? The active bleeds, the non-bleeding vessels, yes. Adherent clots, still somewhat controversial. My own practice is to go after these clots if it's in a favorable location at a favorable time of day, where I'll inject underneath that clot with epinephrine, and then I'll take off the clot with a cold smear guillotine technique, and then wash underneath it and treat underlying vessels that I see. So here's what we do. We can inject, which we don't give injection monotherapy anymore because it's not as good as the other therapies. We can use thermal methods, contact and non-contact. What's been very popular in the U.S. is the use of hemoclips, although you can use bands at times, and combination therapy of epinephrine plus one of these other modalities is what's used most commonly. We all know this. We all do this. So I'm not going to spend more time on this today. I want to tell you what's new here. Well, here's some of the things that are new, and I'm just going to briefly go over this. There are new hemoclips that are coming out. This is a device that's not available in the United States, although there was a similar device available from Ethicon, but went off the market, where there are multiple clips already pre-packaged. So you just clip, and then you go to the next site, clip, and go to the next site, and go clip. And most times that you're taking care of GI bleeding, you're placing two or three clips, and if you had a device that you could just go down and just grab that vessel and go on each side of it or go on each side of that vessel, it would help facilitate therapy. Not available in the United States at the moment. There are over-the-scope clips. These are big clips that are more like clamps, as Ben Mueller likes to say, that go over the tip of the scope. These are like our banding devices, and you suction in the area, and then you deploy the clips. You can have sharp teeth or dull teeth, and there are a couple of varieties. And now there's great evidence coming out about these, the role of these clips. And these are two retrospective studies looking at over-the-scope clips for primary control. So no modality has been given yet, and the first thing you're doing is trying an over-the-scope clip. The first patient paper that came out is like other first papers that come out. It was too good to be true. 100% efficacy, worked in all patients, but it looked very promising. The second paper, I think, is a little closer to probably reality, in that the technical success was in 92%, and there was some rebleeding, but it was reduced markedly in that. So this may be an alternative to standard whatever we're doing, clips or combination therapy, and especially in high-risk patients. Over-the-scope clips have also been used for patients with rebleeding. So these are patients who have already had an endoscopic therapy, and now they're bleeding again. We know that those patients are higher risk to have bad outcomes. They typically have a 25 to 50% rate of further bleeding. If you use an over-the-scope clip, what can happen? Well, your hemostasis rates are about 97%, and rebleeding rates are now 7% in one study that's out there. So that seems like it's a promising thing in those rebleeders. How about monopolar cautery? Well, we have this device available to us, and it's used primarily by the ESD docs, this coagulation forceps device. It looks like a hot biopsy forceps, except it rotates and it does not have a cutting forceps. It just grafts. And it's used widely in ESD to cauterize vessels, but there is an emerging data about the use of these devices in non-variceal bleeding. There are currently two prospective randomized controlled trials, and there are other uncontrolled trials. And these small trials, about 100 patients each, one of them compared the monopolar cautery with the soft coag versus clips, and the other one compared it to heater probes. If you look at it compared to hemoclips, they had a similar efficacy, initial control and rebleeding. And if you looked at it compared to heater probes, at least in the one trial, it seemed to have better efficacy. And my point about this is it's nice to have this around. There are times with whatever you're doing, it's not working. And you can pull these out, and they're easy devices to use, and they will work at times. And I've used it primarily as a rescue method, but it's worked in a couple of cases. You can do ablation techniques, and we've traditionally used RF. APC on vascular ectasias, but you can use RFA and cryotherapy. These are mainly small case therapy, case series. There's no controlled data, although there's reasonable success rates. This is typically more costly. The data is mainly in gastric antral vascular ectasia or watermelon stomach or radiation proctitis, where you can use this as a rescue therapy if you have further bleeding after APC. And then we've already mentioned the topical hemostatic agents. And there are several out there. TC325, which was marketed as Hemostray, is this procoagulant spray that is marketed and available in most countries, although not available in the US at the current time. And the concept, and this is from an article of Dr. Barkin that was in GIE, that you have a catheter, you put it in the area of an ulcer, and you spray, and it coats the area of the ulcer, and basically it causes desiccation with it, pulls up the fluid, and then it's procoagulant, and it seems to be very interesting and work pretty well. Dr. Barkin's group did a review of this, and it showed that this was effective in 92% of cases, although there's a high rebleed rate with the use of hemispray, up to about 20-21%. Particularly in the high-risk lesions, you have a high risk of further bleeding, so you need to think about doing a second modality after you treat these patients. And it seems overall to be safe in most of the reports. There are some considerations about this this device. What I like about it, it does not seem to require special expertise. You just need to get in the area, and perhaps in difficult locations, it'll be effective. It has a potential role in malignant bleeding. And we're going to see later on at this meeting on the Tuesday session, Dr. Barkin's going to present the first randomized controlled trial of the use of hemospray in the treatment of malignant bleeding. And it does show a significantly improved benefit compared to their control group. It only works if you're actively bleeding and you need to provide a second modality, so it's usually a second endoscopy. And our problem in the United States, it's not FDA approved, and we keep hoping it's going to get approved, but it's not clear if and when that's going to happen. A couple of other things to mention, endoscopic suturing. We use suturing for a variety of things today, mainly bariatric work and fistulas. So you have to be familiar with these devices, but they have been applied to ulcers and some refractory ones with some case report type success in the literature. We've heard about EUS-guided variceal therapy. There's also EUS-guided non-variceal therapy, basically getting at the base of the feeding vessels and applying a therapy, and it's a wide variety of therapies, and the experience has been mainly in the Mayo Clinic to date. But if you do this, you can see that you get complete cessation of the blood in a good number of patients and no further bleeding in 88% in the reports thus far. So it may be a helpful modality if you have these tools. Now, how about predictors of rebleeding? This remains a problem, and I pulled a paper from Joe Elmunzer, who is best known now for his work in indomethacin and ERCP, but before he did that, he was a GI bleeding person and did work showing some of the risk factors for rebleeding, including initial hemodynamic instability, comorbidity, active bleeding, large ulcers, and different sites that are high risk. And Doppler probes might be an answer, at least partly, to this. These have been around since 1986. They're easy to use through the scope devices that you listen for a signal. And we've been waiting for a while for Dean Jensen's paper, and it finally came out this year, where he did this randomized prospective controlled patients trial of patients with severe upper GI bleeding, randomized to using Doppler as an endpoint to ablate that vessel or standard visually guided hemostasis. And he found a rebleeding rate of 26% in the standard group versus 11% in the Doppler group. Number needed to treat a very low 7. So it seemed to be very promising, and you should think about it in these very high-risk patients, and it is easy to use. So back to my case, the big ulcer that I saw with the big vessel in the gastrojejunal area here. This is what I chose to do. This is unedited portion of video where I put on an over-the-scope clip. I came up to the vessel, and as I pulled up to it, it's just like band ligation. Come over, I thought I engaged it well, suctioned in with a lot of suction, and then when I was happy with it, I threw the device and deployed the clip, and that was the end of the bleeding. Now, this one went particularly well. The vessel didn't blow, which they can blow and have a lot of bleeding, and the ulcer turned out to be relatively pliable, and it came into it. So it doesn't always go that well, but it certainly can and was a good modality in this case. So to summarize some take-home points for you all, perform endoscopy after your initial resuscitation and within 24 hours in patients who are admitted for upper GI bleeding. Rarely do you need to do it closer, but in those patients who you think have ongoing active bleeding. The standard endoscopic therapies are still the standard combination therapy, epi with cautery or epi with clips or clips alone. These are your fundamental therapies. Over-the-scope clips, I think, are an easy modality to use. And I think you should start thinking about including them in your practice for large vessels or for patients who have rebleeding. Monopolar cautery with these coagulation graspers is a promising alternate therapy, also easy to use and may bail you out at times. Doppler probe is also an intriguing new method that may help decreasing rebleeding rates. And thank you for your attention.